Hello, beautiful watchers, and welcome back to Lost in Adaptation, the show that scrutinizes the various decisions made while converting novels into cinematic productions. Ah, Roald Dahl, beloved children's book author and fucking psychopath. Seriously, have you ever stopped to think about how many people are brutally killed in his novels? He's got herbivores eating people, and even fruit can be fatal. Being of a somewhat weak-stomached temperament, I've decided to ease my way into his works by starting with an early story of his that hopefully contains the smallest body count. Charlie in the Chocolate Factory. Yeah. For the first time, I'm presented with two options for feature films to compare it to. Which one to go with? I think it's gonna have to be... Well, that was, unusual. Anyway, as I was about to say, the only logical choice is the original, directed by Mel Stewart.
Who can take a sunrise, sprinkle it with dew, cover it in chocolate and a miracle or two? The Candyman can.
Originally released in 1971, it's one of those films that did reasonably well at the box office and then built up more momentum as the years went by, enjoying a much more profitable re-release in 1996. It currently appears to be enjoying the best of two worlds, being considered to be a cult classic and a household name. Anyways, without further ado, let's jump straight into... Just like with Jurassic Park, the author of the book also helped write the screenplay for the film, but unlike Jurassic Park, it seems that in this case he was more successful at protecting the plot from being changed for no apparent reason. It's true to the novel in as far as every cast member, important plot point, and the ending made it through just fine. In both versions, Willy Wonka is the proud owner of an awesome chocolate factory staffed by abnormally small workers and employing some unorthodox but apparently very effective chocolate making techniques. They spend their days constantly pushing the boundaries of science in a very chocolatey specific manner. Eventually, he starts to feel his age and, currently having no heir, uses golden tickets to invite five children and their guardians to tour his factory so he can choose someone to succeed him. During said tour, the children continually get themselves into industrial accidents and have to leave early, until only Charlie remains. Wonka reveals his true intentions to an overjoyed Charlie, and it's sort of implied that the flaws in the other children may have been improved by their traumatic experiences, so I guess happy endings all round? Charlie's first three failed attempts at getting a ticket are in the book. It was a very clever way of playing with your expectations, as you kind of knew he was going to get one, but he just never seemed to. Now, you would think that the musical numbers would be film only, and for the most part that's true. However, the Oompa Loompas did in fact burst into ad-lib songs about the fates of the lost children. Even though the book was generally very light-hearted, the scary boat ride was actually in it, although they didn't go as far as to decapitate a chicken or anything. Gosh, who would have thought the other movie that I'm not reviewing would turn out to be the less disturbing one?
Come with me and you'll see a whole new world of minor movie changes. I can't sing, but you get the point.
Taking an overview first, I'd have to say the biggest change is the comedy in the film. It made a lot more effort to be funny than the book, which relied more on whimsy to engage the audience.
People like Charlie's eccentric teacher and other characters with short appearances are added to help infuse this new humorous element, along with gags like the Queen bidding on a chocolate auction. They also played up people's obsession with finding the chocolate bars to a new extreme level. People were very excited about it in the book, but it wasn't the world-ending phenomenon like it was in the film. In the film, Charlie's grandparents take a highly optimistic approach to his chances of winning a golden ticket, which is a little annoying because their attitude in the book was a good balance of good-natured encouragement mixed in with setting realistic expectations. Charlie claims that he was buying the second bar of chocolate for his grandfather in the film, however in the book it was strictly for himself, bearing in mind that his family is starving to death at this point and the money that he found could be very important to them. This is interesting to me because the thought occurs that it essentially means that Charlie was richly rewarded for his only act of selfish decadence in his life, which is a rather odd moral. Unsettling things like the human hand coat hooks, the super fine print liability waiver, and the freaky perception corridor are film only. Unlike the film, I didn't get the impression that Willy Wonka was ever so slightly aroused by the children's misfortunes in the book. He seemed more committed to trying to save them from themselves.
Stop, don't, come back.
Gene Wilder's portrayal of Willy Wonka was okay. He nailed the man's insatiable enthusiasm and his almost childlike desire to impress people with his creations, but he was also kind of a dick in the way that the book Wonka wasn't. Things like him thwacking his cane in front of people all the time, his obvious pleasure at people's discomfort, and his full-on rage-outs are film only. To summarise, I quite liked the book version of Wonka, but this jerk can suck my... everlasting gobstopper. Just look at the way he responds to direct questions in some weird and clearly made-up gobbledygook language.
Mesdames et messieurs, maintenant nous allons faire un petit voyage.
Utter nonsense, I say. Grandpa Joe is actually meant to be 96, but come on, try and find an actor that old. Oh, well, I guess Christopher Lee. That's ironic. Book Charlie would have been quite shocked at Film Charlie's passive-aggressive whining at his mother being more preoccupied with slowly starving to death after his father lost his job and could no longer feed them. The happy-go-lucky chocolate store owner was crazy fat in the book.
Kid, he's giving away free samples, just go inside.
In fact, you'll notice most of these supposedly chocoholics are surprisingly slender in the film. Even Augustus Gloop, whose character is based around being a glutton, isn't particularly massive. Mr. Slugworth, aka Wilkinson, the creepy scarred pretend spy master, wasn't in the book, and neither was the honesty test that Wonka employed him to perform. Slugworth and the everlasting gobstoppers are both mentioned in passing, but aren't relevant in any way to the story. This extra plot point probably represents the single greatest liberty that Stewart took, as it entirely changes Wonka's method for choosing his successor. He wasn't testing the children at all in the book. He was just planning to get to know them during the tour and then pick his favourite out at the end. Charlie essentially just ended up winning by default. Also, Wonka was probably thinking, holy crap, there's only one boy with enough common sense to survive more than a day in here? It may interest you to hear that the Oompa Loompas were even smaller in the book, being described as being no larger than a child's doll. There's also not one single word about them being orange and green. Yeah, I was surprised too. I'm now going to digress into something entirely irrelevant to this dissection, but I couldn't help but observe in the book. Wonka claimed that the Oompa Loompas were having a terrible time in the jungle and he was doing them a great favour in giving them jobs in his factory. But he also then mentions that he shipped them there in packing crates with air holes in them, pays their wages in beans, and tests all his new inventions on them with sometimes potentially fatal consequences. Add that to the Oompa Loompas apparently making up songs to sing while they work, and suddenly you have more slavery overtones than iRobot. I don't know, maybe I'm reading too much into it, but you know? Fuck.
Charlie and Grandpa Joe's disobedient consumption of the fizzy lifting drink and their subsequent airborne shenanigans are not in the book. Wonka talks about the experimental liquid and how he really shouldn't have tested it on an Oompa Loompa outside, then the tour moves on without incident.
The Golden Egg-Laying Geese are a film-only substitution for a room full of squirrels trained to test and de-shell walnuts. Considering that with the special effects available at the time, the only feasible way of doing this would be to actually train an army of squirrels, I'm more than willing to forgive them for this change. There isn't a cream-blasting Wonka-mobile in the book. I'm beginning to suspect Mel Stewart had a few issues of his own to work through. What? What? You thought just because I used long words that I wasn't a horrific pervert? You don't know me. Wonka's hearthroom, creative and apparently entirely devoid of symbolism, was not in the book at all.
Okay, let's see if they managed to leave anything out of a full feature adaptation of a relatively short book.
On a minor note, in the book, the kids were allowed to bring both their parents if they so wanted, and everyone except Charlie did so, so there are quite a few more adults knocking around in the original story. On a major note, Charlie's father wasn't dead and he was in the book! He just had a shit-paying job in a toothpaste factory. Why'd you kill off his father, Stuart, you mean-spirited git? This isn't a Disney film, you're allowed to have two loving parents! Near the start of the book, Grandpa Joe tells Charlie about the time that Wonka was commissioned by an Indian prince to build him a palace entirely made out of chocolate, which he does. The prince, unfortunately, then ignores Wonka's advice to eat it quickly, as he has decided to live in it instead. The palace, of course, melts in the sun the next day. This sounds like a really hilarious scene, it's a damn shame they left it out. They confirmed without a shadow of a doubt that at the end of the book, the other children had survived, albeit with some deforming abnormalities now. Fuck you, Stuart! I spent years thinking Wonka might have murdered them! Hells, there's pages and pages of pointless conspiracy theories online now about how Wonka might be a cannibal, all because you just had to cut out the bit describing the bit where the kids walk home at the end.
The Dom's final thoughts. It's definitely a good movie, and as an adaptation it was probably better than most, but I gotta say, I was a little disappointed. It's the small changes. Individually they didn't amount to much, but there was just so many of them at the end I couldn't help but feel that Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory wasn't Charlie in the Chocolate Factory anymore. So there it is. Kinda wish I'd taken a chance and gone with a reboot now, to be honest. Oh well, until next time, beautiful watchers. Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Yeah. For the first time, I'm presented with two options for feature films to compare it to. Which one to go with? I think it's gonna have to be... Well, whatever that was, it was quite unsettling. Anyways, I thought just to be unorthodox, I might try going with a reboot, directed by Tim Burton.
Generosity. Released in 2005, the film has received remarkably well considering the growing hostility towards reboots. It's got Burton's fingerprints all over it cinematically. Whether you like this or hate this will probably depend more on your feelings towards Burton than your feelings towards the book, so I deem it irrelevant. To be honest, I'm probably not going to be doing that many other reboots after this episode. The reason being that, for better or worse, they're not just adapting the book, they're adapting the first film as well, incorporating the successful element and learning from its mistakes. However, for a number of reasons, including my belief that things have to be able to stand up on their own merits, and I can't be asked changing my format, I'm not going to be taking that into account in this episode. I'm going to be comparing the reboot straight to the book.
The part at the beginning about Wonka being driven into closing his factory due to spies stealing his secrets was true to the book, along with it mysteriously reopening despite no one entering or leaving. The manner in which each of the kids gets themselves in trouble inside the factory is the same in the book and the film, as well as Wonka's motivation for sending out the tickets, i.e. to find someone to inherit his business. If you've not read the book, it would be understandable to assume that things like people telling Willy Wonka that Oompa Loompa Land didn't exist, and that a lot of his actions and statements were at best contradictory, and at worst criminally insane, was the film gently poking fun at the novel, but oddly enough, no, those lines were actually in there along with Wonka's obvious deflections. Burton also successfully visualises a story that Grandpa Joe tells Charlie near the start of the book about the time Wonka was commissioned by an Indian prince to build him a palace entirely made out of chocolate, which he does. The prince, unfortunately, then ignores Wonka's advice to eat it quickly as he has decided to live in it instead. The palace, of course, melts in the sun the next day. This was a remarkably stupid scene, and quite possibly a racist one, which I really wish they'd left out. The locational setting of the book was a little vague, presumably so the reader could subconsciously set it in their own country and therefore relate to it more strongly. Difficult to do in the film because, well, you've got to pick an accent, but Burton managed to salvage at least some of this by mixing in some American accents with the British, and other subtle things you may not have noticed, like the money being in dollars rather than pounds. Also, a little fun fact for my American brothers, the word candy isn't a synonym for chocolate over here, so it was a little weird hearing a British kid using it as such. The boat ride down the chocolate river is true to the book, although they may have made it a tad more dramatic. Has anyone else noticed that a lot of films these days are going out of their way to include future theme park rides? Characters like Augustus Gloop, the morbidly obese, and Veruca, the spoiled brat, were pretty much perfect to their book counterparts. Charlie himself is pretty accurate. In my opinion, when Roald Dahl wrote in a kid as the lead, he tended to leave them pretty bland, I'm guessing so whoever was reading it could project themselves into his place. So wow, I was expecting Burton to take a dump all over the original story, but he's actually stuck to it really well. I mean, he's modernised everything, but that's okay, it's sometimes nice to see things from your generation's perspective. And so far, there hasn't been any... Wait, what's happening? Burton, what are you doing? Burton, no! What are you doing? No! What is this silliness?
I'm going to come back to that later, beautiful watchers. For now, taking an overview, I'd have to say that the biggest change is the weirdness of the film. With Johnny Depp in the lead and Burton directing, what else would you expect? But Dahl's preferred weapon of choice was childlike whimsy, so this represents a significant shift in tone.
Faced with a much harder to impress modern audience, the film adapters made the inevitable decision to extreme up everything that you saw in the factories. Machines that once went putta 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 zoink now go Sorry, that really was just the best metaphor I could come up with for these changes. You're more than welcome to disagree with me, but I found I couldn't hate the film for this. We have, as a society, just come to expect more pointless explosions from our films. In the film, Charlie's grandparents take a highly pessimistic approach to Charlie's chances of winning a golden ticket, which is a little annoying because their attitude in the book was a good balance of good-natured encouragement mixed in with setting realistic expectations. Johnny Depp's Willy Wonka is funny, visually quirky, and nothing like the Wonka in the novel. A friendly, jovial man full of enthusiasm is suddenly a socially awkward introvert with creepy and rude mannerisms. It also amused me that this was the cleanest shaven that I'd seen Depp in a long time, because in the book, Wonka had a goatee. In the book, Grandpa Joe has no particular history with Wonka, and while this seems like a pointless tie-in at first, it does go away to highlight something that even the novel skipped over, i.e. the depressing consequences of laying off an entire workforce without warning. While it was admittedly a health and safety inspector's worst nightmare, Charlie having his own part of the house to live in was actually a big improvement to having to share a mattress with his mum and dad in the hallway like he had to do in the book. Violet liked to chew gum. That was pretty much the beginning and end of her character. Her overachieving obsession and overbearing mother are a film-only addition. The film modernised the hell out of Mike TV. Rather than just being a television-obsessed kid, he's now a savant genius with anger issues and a video game enthusiast. Now, if they were going to do that, they probably should have updated his name as well to something like Mike First Person Shootery? Shut up, I'm hilarious. Even though it's not in the book, I'm glad Mike pointed out that Wonka is kind of wasting his inventing talents by only applying them to chocolate. If you think about it, if Wonka and the Oompa Loompas had dedicated themselves to, say, applied physics instead of junk food, they might have hit the technological singularity by now. But oh well, at least they invented ice cream that doesn't melt. In the book, Wonka doesn't give out any hints about there being a big prize to win at the end. He promised everyone who attended a lifetime supply of chocolate, and he was true to his word on that, but that was it. The Oompa Loompas weren't identical to each other in the book. They were also kind of dickheads singing about how the missing children were dying horribly, even though you clearly see that they survived at the end.
Okay, I guess I can't put it off forever. Here's where things really start to fall apart, adaptation-wise.
I'm willing to bet that even if you haven't read the book, you will have figured out that the story arc involving Wonka's depressing childhood with Saruman the dentist is 100% Burton only. At the end of the book, Wonka positively insists that the whole family comes along. He even helps Charlie kidnap them against their will because they weren't too keen on coming. Forget I mentioned that, let's not complicate matters. The point is that the last 20 minutes of the film manages to undo all the goodwill Burton had managed to win for me thus far. I could have lived with the flashbacks if they hadn't interfered with the original plot, but it just completely takes over at the end, and it doesn't even go anywhere. Him and his father just instantly hug and make up, and that's the end of it.
Burton, buddy, what happened? You were doing so well, did you really have to-
Oompa Loompa doobity-doo. Burton's working through his daddy issues. He doesn't care if he screws up the plot. He'll do it his way whether you like it or not. It could have been good if he'd thought a little harder and not just cast Depp and Bonham Carter. Goldal would have kicked him right in the jewels. Oompa Loompa doobity doo.
You guys saw that too, right? Hey, wait, that tune was from the other movie, you idiots! As you can probably tell, my beef with this film is more about them crowbarring stuff in than leaving stuff out. Roald Dahl's book was surprisingly short, so it was quite easy to include everything. I think for the first time in making this show, I can't think of a single thing they left out. Even small things in the book, like passing the literal mountain of fudge, was included. Like I said, it's all modernized, but it's all there. So I guess, the Dom's final thought? You fucked it up, Burton. You were doing so well, but you just couldn't stick the landing, could you? I was fine with them embellishing the surreal and borderline magical elements of the story, using the all-powerful CGI to hypercharge the outlandish things described in the novel, but when you change the message to the same bullshit family-togetherness model that's crowbarred into every movie these days, it leaves me wishing I'd gone ahead and reviewed the original after all. But such is life. Farewell, beautiful watchers.
Oompa Loompa doobity-doo. I've got a gun and it's pointing at you. Give us your cash and no one gets hurt, or it's Oompa Loompa bang bang and death.
Well, as muggings go, that was somewhat more musical than I'm used to. Hello, beautiful watchers! If you'd like to help me recuperate some of my recent financial losses, there's a very nice Patreon page you can visit. You're also probably wondering how you can win that $50 gift card. Well, step one is to subscribe to my YouTube channel, simple enough. But then you also need to leave a comment, either on YouTube or on Channel Awesome, I don't mind. In this comment, I'd like to hear about a novel that you've read that hasn't been turned into a film yet, but you would like to see adapted in the future. I'm afraid I can't award extra marks for talking about who you cast or who should direct, but I would be very interested to hear your thoughts on the matter if you feel inclined to do so. Good luck, beautiful watchers, and I will see you next time.